These early stages of life are often referred to as the RNA world. The primary replicator, in fact, the only replicator, is RNA. Now, this viewpoint arises from the fact that if we look at ribosomes, which are essential for translation, they consist of RNA in the blue and white, and there's bits of protein that are added that provide structure to the ribosome. But the sites themselves that are completely active, and they're the ones that hold on to the bits and pieces for translation, they consist entirely of RNA. That implies the RNA got there first, and all the most important tasks in translation are actually being performed by the RNA itself, and then the other bits of protein were added later. So we view this then as evidence of an RNA world. Now, an RNA world looked like this, where you'd have had the RNA molecule itself with the ribosome that's essential now for the manufacture of protein. It's mostly RNA, but it has a bit of protein attached to it. And here are the proteins that are now they're going to provide a phenotype, physical structures, further enhancing the compartmentalization of these protocells. These then have the ability to replicate the entire cell, not just the independent molecules, but the whole complement of all the bits and pieces of the toolkit are now in each separate toolbox of new cells as they're formed. What we would then summarize this process has been is first we have the clay that would allow for the spontaneous generation of long chains of nucleotide because of those slight variations in electrical charge. Somewhere out of all the unbelievable numbers of trillions and larger numbers of abiotic strands of RNA, some happen to have the capacity for self-replication. Somewhere in this time, there would be the formation from the geysers of these lipid vesicles. And these come together. And so when these self-replicators finds itself inside of a lipid vesicle, it's able now to manufacture its ribosomes and hold on to it through that compartmentalization. Through further evolution, the RNA is now acquiring the ability to manufacture proteins that can enhance that phenotype. And so the RNA is now the template for synthesis of protein. And also at some point, we know that cells can now manufacture their own lipids. They wouldn't have to remain close to the geysers, and they could take over the tasks of manufacturing their own cell walls. At some stage in here, we have one of these RNA world cells that has something quite amazing happen, and that is the synthesis of reverse transcriptase. Reverse transcriptase then will take RNA and code it into DNA. And at that point, the DNA would have become the library of genetic information within the cell. That's now recognizable in the modern world, and these are what we would call now bacteria once they have the DNA. But why is this step so important? Remember, reverse transcriptase, we saw in the last lecture, that's how the RNA virus, HIV, once it gets inside the cell, can manufacture DNA from its RNA. And so this encodes DNA from the RNA of the HIV particle, which is then integrated into the host's genome, which is all DNA. So in the early world of RNA only, RNA is capable of self-replication, and there's proteins that would eventually have been manufactured through translation of the RNA. So this can do all of it by itself in an RNA world. You can still get protein from an RNA-only world. But with the DNA, with the addition of reverse transcriptase, so now we have DNA, and from the DNA we then get transcription back to RNA, and then the translation of the RNA down to protein. That's the modern synthesis of how living things manufacture their proteins today. But the DNA library is the important step here, because DNA is a far more stable self-replicator than RNA. We know this because there are still viruses today, or have always been viruses, that have DNA, and there are RNA viruses. And the mutation rate in a DNA virus is really pretty low. We saw that with smallpox. And in fact, the DNA virus mutation rate is only about 1 per 100 or 1,000 replications. It's a pretty stable replicator. But the RNA virus, as we again saw with HIV, part of the problem with fighting HIV infection is that it makes so many mistakes, there's so many mutations, and every time an RNA virus replicates, it makes at least one mistake. So if you want to have a lot of complex information safely stored so you can manufacture the complex proteins like hemoglobin and insulin and all these other things, you need a very stable template, and that's provided by the DNA rather than the RNA. So to summarize, the molecules in the early stages of life would have been subject to the same laws of natural selection as living organisms. RNA molecules that were best able to self-replicate would have become more common. Proteins that assisted the RNA in replicating itself became fixed. You'd have enzymes that were specifically there to improve the efficiency of the process of replication. And then also these proteins would have been co-opted into manufacturing the cell's own lipids to ensure a stable environment to really make a very safe compartment for further replication. Then with the origins of DNA, all of these very complex phenotypic traits could be very accurately copied from one generation to the next.